boys and girls. I'm going to read another story to you today. This story is called The Lion King, and I have a very special guest who is going to help us read this book. I'm going to introduce you to our guest. Can anybody guess what it is? Our guest is Simba. All right, so we are going to read The Lion King. The moon had vanished one by one. The stars faded from the cold night. Behind the dark eastern hills, the sun rose, turning the flat-topped acacia trees from black to green. Once again, it was dawn in Africa. This was a very important day. Hurry, the animals urged one to another. Today's the day we go to Pride Rock. We can't be late. Up from the wide valleys and down from the hills, they paraded across the plain. Cheetahs, the fastest of all, led the way. The dusty ground shook beneath a million drumming hooves and the flopping feet of the elephants and the rhinos. Silent giraffes, followed by their gangly babies, looped alongside herds of excited zebras, at the rear troops of chattering baboons carrying by their alert youngsters on their backs. The air was crowded and noisy with the flap and flutter of the countless wings, birds of all sizes and colors flying from far away, rivers and trees shaded the back of the traveling animals. The trip was long, and as the animals approached to Pride Rock, the plain shimmered in the morning heat. Everyone assembled at the foot of the mountain and waited. When are we going to see the new prince? A young giraffe asked. Soon, his father said. From the back of a throne in an ancient baboon slowly made his way from the foot of the Pride Rock. Supporting himself on the walking stick, he carefully climbed to the face of the mountain. That's Rafiki, the great mystic, an elephant explained to her child. When King Mufasa was a cub, Rafikiti waited for him. Watched out for him. Now he has to come give little Simba his blessing. A blue-feathered hornbell glided down from the summit of Pride Rock. Look here, comes Zazu, the elephant mother said, pointing with her trunk. He is checking to see if we're all here. Zazu circled about the crowd a few times. Then he flew back to the top of the rock, disappearing from the sight of the patient gathering. He landed in the feet of the golden maned lion. King Mufasa, Zazu reported. Everyone's arrived. And Rafikiti is on his way up. The elephants are here, and the wild beast, as well as the... Why, thank you, Zazu, said Mufasa. That will do. In a few minutes, Rafikiti's shaggy gray head appeared at the edge of the rock. King Mufasa embraced his old friend. There, said Rafikiti. I have made it with hardly a scratch. He looked around. Now where is this young lad? Mufasa smiled and nodded toward his mate. He is over there with Queen Sabiria, he answered. Here is Simba, said Sabiria, gently handing the spotted cub over to Rafiki. The cub looked up and blinked. The strange old baboon. Rafiki grinned toothfully at Mufasa. It's as if I'm seeing you, a cub, all over again. Now that little prince, I will give you my blessing, he said, and patted Simba on his head. Rafiki slowly untied a gourd from his walking stick. He leaned over and shook it several times against the watchful cub. Then he cracked the gourd open, removed something sticky, and smeared it on Simba's forehead. The cub wrinkled his nose. Almost finished, the elderly baboon said kindly. He scooped up a handful of dust and sprinkled it over Simba's back. Simba sneezed, and they all laughed. Then Rafiki scooped down and with great care gathered up King Mufasa and Queen Sabiria's son. He carried the cub to the edge of the Pride Rock. The ground below had been waiting eagerly for this moment. There he is, one of them shouted. Rafiki's holding the new prince. At once, everyone cheered and stamped their feet. "Welcome," they shouted. "Welcome to Prince Simba." Rafiki waited for the dust to settle. Then he raised Simba high in the air. The clouds parted and the shaft of the sunlight broke through, shining down on the future king. The animals fell silent and bowed. Rafiki slowly lowered his arms and took Simba back out of sight. As the afternoon sun began its descent in the western sky, the animals turned to make their new way home. Later that afternoon, Zazu flew to the shaded part of Prince Rock and landed at the feet of another lion, the king's younger brother. "It gave me pleasure to announce the visit of King Mufasa," said Zazu. "And you'd better have a good excuse for missing this morning's ceremony."
"Oh, I quiver with fear," said Scar calmly.
"What was that?" asked Mufasa, suddenly appearing. "Sarbi and I didn't see you at the presentation of Simba. Is anything wrong?"
"That was today?" asked Scar, pretending to be disappointed.
"Oh, I feel simply awful. Must have slipped my mind."
"You should have been first in line," said Zazu. "After all, you're the king's brother."
"I was first in line until I had a hairball was born," Scar snorted, then padded away.
"Don't turn your back on me, Scar," ordered Mufasa. Scar spun around and faced his brother.
"Oh no, Mufasa," he growled. "Perhaps you shouldn't turn your back on me."
"Is that a challenge?" demanded Mufasa.
Without answering, Scar quickly retreated. Zazu started to ease his master's frustration. "There's one in every family, sir," he said, "and they've always managed to rule on special occasions. What am I going to do with him?" Mufasa muttered under his breath.
Okay, boys and girls, we are going to start chapter 2.
The days passed quickly for Simba. There was so much to learn and to do. One morning before sunrise, when it was still dark and chilly, he trotted over to his sleeping father and gently nudged him. "Dad," he whispered eagerly into Mufasa's ear. No answer. Simba spoke a little louder. "Hey, Dad! Wake up, Dad!" Mufasa sighed in his sleep and turned over. "Dad! Dad! 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 Dad!" Simba pressed on. Sarabi sleepily opened her eyes. "Your son is awake," she said to her mate. "Before sunrise, he's your son," Mufasa grumbled. Sarabi nudged his hand. "You told him to get you up early this morning." Mufasa's eyes popped open.
"I know, I'm up.
Sarabi reached out, pulled Simba close to her, and licked his face and ears. "Your father has some important things to tell you today," she said, "so you'd better have clean ears." "Mom," said Simba, wiggling free. In the dim light, Mufasa and Simba strolled far across the pride land. All over the plain, dainty tan and white gazelles, bruisedly wagging their tails, nibbled on the grass. As Mufasa and Simba passed by, they scattered, leaping stiff-legged, kicking their heels behind them. A glowing orange ball appeared on the eastern horizon. The sun was beginning a new day. Its heat burned away the morning mist, and Simba felt the ground warming beneath his feet. The sun's long rays reached out far, sweeping across the plain, looking right to the land. "Look at the rays of the rising sun, Simba," the king told him. "Everything the light touches is our kingdom." Simba was impressed. "That's just about everywhere." "The king's time as a ruler rises and falls like the sun," his father said. "One day the sun will set on my time here. It will rise with you as the new king." "And this land will be mine?" asked Simba. "Everything," said Mufasa. Simba blinked and scanned the bright plain. Moon gooses nearby popped out in the land of abandoned termite mounds. Out along the sunny horizon, thirsty zebras slowly walked in a single file to a crowded water hole. But far to Simba's left, the land was hazy and still.
What about that shadowy place? He asked.
That's beyond our border, said Mufasa. You must never go there, my son.
Simba tried not to act disappointed. But I thought a king can do whatever he wants. His father smiled. There's nothing more to being a king than getting your way all the time. There's more to being a king than getting your way all the time.
Do you think I'll be a good king, Dad? Simba asked.
Mufasa grew serious and looked into his son's eyes.
You will be a good king if you remember this. Everything you see exists together in a delicate balance. As king, you need to understand and preserve that balance. You must respect all creatures, from the crawling ant to the leaping antelope.
But we eat the antelope, said Simba.
Yes, we do, said Mufasa. Let me explain. When we die, our bodies become the grass. Then the antelope eat the grass. And so we are all connected in the great circle of life.
Good morning, sir, a voice squawked down to them. It was Zazu. The hornbill landed in the heap of the king's feet. I have the morning report.
All right, Zazu, said Mufasa. Let's hear it.
Zazu cleared his throat and began to speak in an official voice.
The buzz from the bees is that the leopards are in, well, a bit of a spot.
Simba was bored. A butterfly flitted past him, setting on the tiny flower growing close to the ground. The cup pounced, and the butterfly quickly flew away. While Zara droned on, Mufasa began and whispered to Simba.
What are you doing, son?
He asked.
Simba, what are you doing, son?
Pouncing, said Simba. But I missed.
Zazu paused and waited.
Come on, said Mufasa. Zazu cleared his throat again and went on. The baboons are going to eat. Of course the giraffes are acting like they're above it all. Let an old pro show you how to do it.
Mufasa quietly said to Simba, while Zazu recited his report.
Zazu, would you turn around?
Of course, sir, said Zazu. With his back to the king, he continued. The tick birds are picking up the elephants, I told him. The elephants to forget it, but they can't.
Remember, Simba, Mufasa whispered to his son. Stay low to the ground.
And the termites, as usual, reported Zazu, are boring, boring, boring.
Oh, what's going on? He asked, glancing behind him.
Don't worry, answered Mufasa. Just a little lesson in pouncing.
Oh, very well, said Zazu. Turning back around, Simba was only pouncing. Pouncing! Trying not to make a sound.
Mufasa instructed his son.
Simba, crunching low, made his way towards Zazu.
Sir, protested Zazu over his shoulder, you can't be serious. This is humiliating. For me to be so degraded, a muffled scrambling sound stomped the indignant hornbell in mid-sentence. An exhausted mole popped his head out of a small hole in the ground. Berry-eyed and sneezing dust, he quickly whispered in Zazu's ear and disappeared again.
Sir, there's news from the underground, said Zazu.
Hyenas have been spotting crossing into the Pride Lands.
Hyenas.
Mufasa looked concerned. Zazu said, Simba, home. Well, I'll look into this, he said, starting to leave.
Now let me go with you, please, Dad,
Simba begged. No, the king called back. It could be dangerous. Zazu escorted Simba back to the foot of Pride Rock.
Thank you, Zazu, said the cub. I can go to the rest of the way myself.
He left his father's secretary and scrambled up the rock ledges. Halfway to the summit, he came across Scar, snoozing on an overhanging rock. The thin lion opened his eyes. It was half covered by a stringy black mane.
Oh, he said, looking down at Simba. It's just you.
Uncle Scar, cried Simba. Guess what?
I despise guessing games, said Scar.
I'm going to be king of Pride Rock, announced Simba.
Scar yawned.
Oh, goody, he said. Well, forgive me for not leaping for joy.
Bad back, you know.
My dad just showed me the whole kingdom, Simba said, and someday I'll rule it all.
Scar's other eye popped open while he thought this over for a minute.
So your father showed you the whole kingdom, did he?
Everything, said Simba.
He didn't show you what's beyond the northern border? Asked his uncle.
Well, no, said Simba. He said I can't go there.
Scar yawned again.
And he's absolutely right. It's far too dangerous.
Only the bravest of lions can go there.
He closed his eyes. Now go away and let me get a little shut-eye.
Uncle Scar, said Simba, I'm brave. Please tell me what's out there.
No, said Scar firmly, keeping his eyes closed. I'm only looking for your well-being. An elephant graveyard is no place for a young prince.
An elephant what? Asked Simba.
This sounded interesting. Scar opened his eyes wide.
Oops, he said with a grin.
Oh dear, I've said too much. But you were so clever. I'm sure you'd found a way sooner or later. Just do me a little favor, will you? Promise me you'll never visit that dreadful place. And don't tell anyone I told you, he added. It will be our little secret.
Sure, said Simba. He ran off to find his best friend, Nala. He couldn't tell her how he knew, but he could tell her what he knew.
And that's the end of chapter 2.
Hey, boys and girls, we are starting chapter 3.
Chapter 3. Simba played with Nala almost every day. They climbed trees together, wrestled, and raced across the plain. Now he couldn't wait to tell her about the elephant graveyard. He heard his mother's voice and found her visiting Sarfina, Nala's mother. They were resting in the shade of the Kingla trees behind Pride Rock. Sarfina was giving her impatient daughter a bath.
Hold still, please, Nala, she scolded. Let me finish washing your face. Just a couple more licks and you can go.
Hi, everybody, said Simba.
Be with you in a minute, said Nala.
I hope. While he waited, Simba played with the heavy sausage-like fruits that fell from the trees.
How was your walk? Sarbiri asked her son.
Fine, said Simba. Dad had to go and check on some hyenas. They came over to our lands.
Sarbi was startled. Really? Again? I hope he runs them off. Those hyenas are nothing but trouble.
Can Nala come out and play? Simba asked Sarfina.
Sarfina looked at Sarbi.
Do you think it's safe? She asked. With the hyenas running around loose?
Sarbir thought about it.
Well, she said, it's all right with me as long as Zazu goes with them. Simba's shoulders slumped.
Please, mother, he begged. Can we go alone? We're getting pretty big, said Nala.
And strong, said Simba, puffing out his chest.
Not today, said Sarabi. She scanned the top of the Kingla trees and spotted Zazu settling down for a nap.
Zazu, she called, I'd like you to keep an eye on Simba and Nala this afternoon.
Zazu blinked. He was supposed to be off duty.
Oh, well, he flew down to the ground. Simba and Nala strolled over to him.
Step lively, said Zazu. The sooner we go, the sooner we can return.
Yeah, Simba said. We'll run out on ahead. The two cubs scampered onto the plain, talking and giggling.
Where are we going? Asked Nala.
An elephant graveyard, answered Simba.
Nala's eyes grew big.
Really? She asked.
Shh, said Simba, slowing down and whispering. Zazu. Right, Nala nodded. She whispered back, how are we going to ditch the doo-doo?
Watch out, here he comes.
Well, said Zazu, fluttering around them. Just look at you two telling secrets. Little seeds of romance blossoming in the savannah. It's so perfect, being that you're betrothed and all.
Be what? Asked Simba. What's that?
You and Nala are betrothed,
sang out Zazu.
Indeed.
Officiated.
Huh?
Said Simba and Nala.
It means, explained Zazu, one day you two are going to be married.
Married? Said Simba and Nala. Us?
You, said Zazu.
I can't marry Nala, said Simba. She's my friend.
Right, agreed Nala. We don't want to get married.
Sorry to burst your bubble, said Zazu, but you two turtle doves have no choice. It's all been settled by your parents.
It's an old tradition that goes back generations.
Well, we'll see, said Simba. When I'm king, that'll be a first tradition to go. Come on, Nala. I'll race you to that big termite mound.
The cubs dash away.
Oh, dear. They're off again, said Zazu.
Wait for me!